Okay, we're back now. We're talking about solving systems of equations, and we need a systematic method because probably as you can recall from your days in college algebra, once you get up to even a 3x3 system, then things start to get a little messy. And so we're going to talk now about how to a systematic method, okay, a method that will work no matter what size your system, no matter how many rows, how many columns, or how many variables, how many equations. It's an algorithm that will work no matter what. Before we do that, I want to go back and look at that system that we were talking about earlier, which I have on my notepad here. So remember, I just want to refresh your memory about what we did there. The second way we used to solve this system, if you recall, was we decided to multiply this equation by -2, and then we added that to the second equation. So let's just go through that quickly again. So we end up with -4x1 -6x2 equals -48, right? And then we added that. So the x1's canceled out. Then we ended up with -5x2 here equals -20. So x2 is equal to 4. And then we didn't actually do it because we'd done it before, but I'll go through. At this point, to find x1, you have to plug back in. You can plug into either one. Let's just go back to the first one. First equation, we'll have 2x1 plus 3 times x2, and we know that x2 is 4, so we plug that in, equals 24. So we get 2x1 equals, looks like 12, so x1 equals 6. So there's our solution that we found in the previous video. To do this in a systematic way, we set up a matrix, okay? And a matrix is just a rectangular array of numbers, okay? So in this case, we would be interested in this matrix, okay, where I take the coefficients, right? And so I just write it like that. So the first row here represents the first equation. Second row represents the second equation. This matrix is called an augmented matrix, and it's called augmented because it has this right-hand side column included. A lot of times we're only interested in this matrix, which we call the coefficient matrix, since it coefficient number, think about how to spell that. Since it includes only the coefficients of the variables. So that's coefficient matrix. If we augment or add on the right hand side, then we get the augmented matrix, which is this one. And this is actually the one that we'll work on most of the time when we're solving. If we want to solve a particular system, then we would work with the augmented matrix. Now, what do we do with the augmented matrix? Well, it turns out that there are three row operations, three operations in our toolbox that we can perform on this matrix in order to solve the system. So to do that, let's go back to our slides here. And here we'll talk about our elementary row operations. So number one is to interchange or swap two rows. So that, since a row in a matrix represents an equation, that just means we're reordering the equations, which, as you know, has no effect on the solution. We could also multiply all the entries in a particular row by a non-zero constant. No, can't multiply by zero because that would be essentially throwing out that equation and that wouldn't work. But you can multiply by any non-zero constant. And the other is, sounds kind of complicated, but it's really not. And really this third one is the one that you'll do 99% of the time. Okay, and it is the replacement operation. It's where you replace one row by the sum of itself and that should be a multiple of another row. So you replace one row by the sum of itself and a multiple of another row. It's an error right there. So let's talk about how you do that. Let's go back to our example. Okay, and that operation is actually what we did here. If you go back and look, we replaced, you can think of it as we were replacing the second equation by the sum of itself and a multiple of the first row. Okay, so we multiplied the first row, took a multiple of the first row, added it to the second. And so we ended up with this new equation right here. Okay, so we're going to do the same thing except in matrix form. Okay, and I like to use a shorthand when I'm doing these operations. And so for the replacement operation, I write it like this. I'm going to multiply negative 2 times row 1 and add that to row 2. Okay, so negative 2 times row 1 added to row 2. Now this doesn't change row 1, so I'm just going to write that just as I normally would. No change there. But row 2 is going to change. So I'm going to multiply each entry in row 1 by negative 2 and add it to the corresponding entry in row 2. So I got negative 2 times 2 is negative 4 plus 4. That gives me 0. So I've eliminated x1 from this row. Then negative 2 times 3 is negative 6 plus 1 is negative 5. Okay, so just a reminder there. How did I get that? I multiplied negative 2 times 3 and added it to 1. So negative 2 times this entry plus 1. Then I do the same thing in the third column. So I get negative 2 times negative 24 is negative 48 plus 28 is negative 20. So here I get negative 20. And just to make that clear, that's negative 2 times 24 plus 28. Okay? And so you can see if you wrote out the equation that corresponded to this row, it looks exactly like this equation here that we ended up with. All right? And so at this point, now I have in my second row only one variable, and so I can solve. So I would say, okay, from row 2, I get negative 5x2 equals negative 20. So that means x2 equals 4. Okay, just like I did before. And then we do something. Let me get a little more space here. Then we do a process called back substitution. Okay, and that just means you back up to the next row and you substitute. So if we back up to the next row, then that would be backing up to the first row. And there I've got 2x1 plus 3x2, but now I know what x2 is. It's 4, so that's the substitution part. Okay, so I plug that in, equals 24, and we know that we end up with x1 equals 6 at this point. Okay, so here we've solved the system using elementary row operations and then using back substitution. Let's see. Just one more note on why this is okay to do this. Let's go back to our slides. A little more terminology for you. We say two matrices are row equivalent if there is a sequence of elementary row operations that transforms one matrix into the other. So the way I usually say that is they're row equivalent if you can get from one to the other by doing elementary row operations. Okay? Doesn't mean they're equal. Row equivalent does not mean the matrices are equal. It just means that you can get from one to the other by doing elementary row operations. Okay? And then here's the clincher. That's why this works. Okay? So remember, our goal is to solve a system. And we need to know that when we do these row operations, we're not changing the solution or the solution set. Okay, and so this statement gives us that assurance. It says if the augmented matrices of two systems are row equivalent, then the two systems have the same solution set. So that means we can start off with one matrix, we can do row operations, and get to another one that we can solve easily, and know that the solution that we get based on the last matrix will be the same for the first one. So that's why we can do these row operations in order to solve a system of equations. This leads us to two questions. The first one is the system consistent? Okay, does it have at least one solution? And if that's so, okay, if it's consistent, then is that solution unique, or are there an infinite number of solutions? So we'll talk about how to determine, number one, is the system consistent? Number two, if it is, then how do you know if there's a unique solution or an infinite number of solutions? Okay, we're going to stop here, and I'll do one more video that has some problems worked out for you. So that'll be next.